Can you hear me? Yeah. All right, guys. So today we're going to talk about what can you still do when you can't afford or when you don't have 0 days in terms of client-side exploitation. Okay. So a couple of words about me. I'm the co-author of the Browser Hackers Handbook. Beef lead core developer. I do application security research. Many different areas, and I like Ruby, JavaScript. I used to like Java back in the days. OpenBSD and Black Metal fan. So, outline, why there is still hope without 0 days? I try to like resume this in a couple of points. So, mostly because you can still, for example, exploit Firefox and Chrome extensions. You can abuse legacy functionality. For example, I don't know if you remember the HTML applications in Internet Explorer that are that they were created back in Internet Explorer 6 and they still work in Internet Explorer 11. And it's a feature that Microsoft never wanted to disable for a reason or another one. Office macros, Microsoft Office macros, both for Word and Excel. And another trick that a friend of mine from Italy found on Internet Explorer 9 and 10, which is not patched. So it's patched in Internet Explorer 11, but Microsoft never created like a patch for the previous versions. And there are still a lot of users that use 9 and 10, of course. And then at the end, if we have time, some old tricks that can still work in certain cases, like Java applets and stuff like that. Why there is still hope without 0 days? First of all, because you can still use social engineering. You can trick your victim to do what you want most of the times, especially if you are not interested in targeted attacks, but on mass pwnage on many victims. It's basically like the same concept behind like spam. Human stupidity, of course. People tend to don't be really up to date on, for example, the fact that they need to update a particular browser or a particular plugin, or, for example, the fact that they tend to trust certification authorities. And then we are going to see how you can misuse that. For example, there is a specific case we are going to see when Symantec and Microsoft did an agreement. So when you use Enterprise Validation SSL and you sign applets or executables with it, then you can do some interesting stuff in Internet Explorer. Trust in browser extensions, of course. I mean, how many of you, even when you install a browser extension, you are actually checking the source code? Not many, probably. And even less if you consider like non-technical users. And abuse of legacy functionality. So HTML applications, Microsoft Office macros, and stuff like that. The first thing about browser extensions is why you want to use browser extensions, because they are basically super web applications. So they run with different privileges. Code that runs in an extension always has different privileges, higher privileges. And then with finding a bug in an extension, you can achieve most of the time like same origin policy bypasses, universal XSS, so you control every open tab. And in certain cases, like with Firefox, you can even get very easily a reverse shell, if that's what you want to do. Obviously, they need to be installed, so the tricky part is that, again, we are not speaking about 0 days where you point the victim to a link, the victim lands on that link, and then automatically something is exploited in the browser or in the JavaScript renderer, whatever it is. In this case, you still need the user to click and to allow something. And there are different kind of techniques to increase the likelihood that it's going to do that. Obviously, lots of XSS. Actually, this I could remove this bullet point because this is a presentation me and another friend, Krzysztof, gave in March in Insomnihack in Switzerland. But yeah, no 0 days will be disclosed. It's actually against the OWASP policy, I guess, from this year, so whatever. So Firefox extensions. Firefox extensions are still the most funny one to play with because there is no sandbox. So currently Firefox latest version doesn't have a sandbox for like the JavaScript renderer or other components, while Chrome does. So if you find, for example, a use after free, then you find a memory leak to bypass SLR, for example, then you have job done. You don't need a sandbox bypass. And additionally, extensions, they run in the same kind of user privilege area than the normal browser. So which means that if you serve, for example, an extension for Firefox on Linux like this, you are gonna have like a reverse shell as soon as the extension is installed. Also, you don't need the, like if you create a bootstrapped extension, the user doesn't need to reboot the browser. So as soon as the extension is installed, you get your shell. Also, another interesting thing about Firefox extensions is that you can serve the extension from any origin. While in Chrome, for example, from Chrome 18 or 19, so back like a couple of years ago, they limited this. So you need to upload the extension in the Chrome Web Store, and the Chrome Web Store is the only allowed origin to install Chrome extension. No, in Firefox you can still like serve it in your own Apache server. You don't need to put it on like the Mozilla website. In Beef we have, how many of you knows Beef? The browser protein? Okay, cool. So we have a couple of modules that trick the user into installing the extension, like the fake flash update, and another couple of ones which I might have time to show you later. This is for Firefox extension. Chrome extensions, actually the guys behind Chrome are actually quite smart. So the old Chrome extensions and the new ones, they changed like the manifest version 1, manifest version 2, which is basically like a JSON file where you define permissions and other properties of the extension. So from manifest version 2, they added the content security policy, which basically minimized the impact of cross-site scripting. In case you have a cross-site scripting in the Chrome extension, having the CSP protects the user from like having me running Beef through the extension. Also, you cannot really embed a dropper like with Firefox extension. So there is not really OS command execution. Unless the application use the NP API, then it might be vulnerable, but it's being deprecated. So still, you can do a lot of stuff, as we're gonna see. Exploiting Chrome extension. So when we did this research with Krzysztof Kotowicz, which now works in Google, pretty funny. Basically, we had like, you just need to have like a credit card, $5 in it, and create a Google account, and then upload a zip file with your extension code on the web store, and basically then you need to convince the users to install the extension from there. So as, because, let me check what time is it, yeah. So because, the web store, the Google web store doesn't offer you an API, like a RESTful API, a SOAP API. You need to do it, when you upload an extension, you need to go in the website, click, upload, the multi-part form request is created and stuff like that. So we actually analyzed the traffic with Burp and we created a bunch of Ruby scripts. So no Python, sorry, Ruby. Scripts to basically automate two phases. One is, you find an extension that is already existing, you download it, you backdoor it with the Beef hook, and then you can control every tab. And second, you automatically can upload it on the web store. So this is all public code now in Beef from like 6 months. So you can use it in case you want to use this kind of attacks. Obviously, when you upload code in the Google web store, apparently they did some kind of audit. They used to have like, as far as I know, manual audit if the application was using NP API, but as far as I know, they do automatic checks only. if you just like, you know, have a bunch of HTML and JavaScript files. And this is actually what you need. Let me show you a video. So in this case, we go to a web store, we search for the extension that we want to backdoor, for example, Gmail Google, an official one. I will speed it up a bit. This is the code that basically is going to be injected in the extension. So we are going to backdoor it, adding this code. The code is using the Chrome extension API, as you can see, to basically say every time the user opens a new tab, inject my malicious JavaScript. And this means that you can control whatever is going on in that tab. So you can read content, you can do actions on the user behalf. You can use either Beef to do that, or you can use a tool that, very cool tool that my friend Krzysztof wrote, which is basically Beef, but tailored only for Chrome extension exploitation. And this is the one that I'm gonna use right now, but again, you can use easily Beef. You just need to basically like create the proper vector pointing back to your server. So here we are generating the proper hook that is going to be the one injected in every tab. And so this is like one of the first script that we wrote. That basically downloads the extension, the sent from sent through Gmail valid extension that already exists in the web store, which is the one that we want to backdoor. So you just need to specify a bunch of parameters, the kind, the JavaScript that you want to inject, and then the permissions that you want the extension to have. So for example, access all tabs, have bidirectional communication on HTTP and HTTPS origin. And here I'm just gonna show how the manifest is. So this is basically the manifest version 2, where you can see that the permission that we are actually modifying from the original extension is access every tab, do bidirectional communication on HTTP and HTTPS origin, which means that you can have full control of what is going on the browser. Then obviously, when the extension is downloaded and backdoored, you can manually edit the files if the script is not enough for you. And then once it's backdoored, so this is basically the backdooring process, and once it's backdoored, the zip file is created, so it's ready to be uploaded, and instead of doing everything, you know, manually, you just need to basically give to the Ruby script, like, you need to be logged in the web application. You just put like your cookie values, and then the Ruby script automatically does all the requests for you and uploads the extension in the Google Web Store. As you can see, this is the configuration file. You just need to add a bunch of things over there. You can choose the description, the screenshot, so it looks exactly the same as we're gonna see in a moment. Publish, and now it's doing a bunch of HTTP requests and uploading the binary content to the web store. And after a bunch of seconds, the extension is going to be published, as you can see. It gives you the published URL. And the only thing that differs, obviously you need to wait depending on like how big is the queue that they need to process, like 60 minutes, an hour and a half, it depends. But then the only thing that is different is this, like ratings or like how many users installed it. All the rest is exactly the same. And once you did that, so your backdoored Chrome extension is uploaded in the web store, what you can do as the next step is use it during your social engineering engagements. So this is the backdoor extension. So we are going to use the beef social engineering extension that I wrote two years ago, before I gave a talk at 44Con in London. So you can the first thing you can do is you can use the social engineering extension via RESTful API in a very easy way. So you just need to basically create your social engineering email template with HTML or plain text, and then say, okay, this is the link I want to show here, and then this is the recipient, this is how I want to spoof the from address, and with just like one request, you are gonna send an email to your victim. As you can see, the email looks like one of those Google emails, which has been just delivered and received by our victim. Beef, in the meantime, is running, obviously, in a way that as soon as the... Beef is used only to send the email. Then we are using, again, Mosquito to actually run the bidirectional channel between the extension and your server. So we are going to clean cache and everything. Also, this step is another feature I'm going to show you at the end, which is implemented both in Mosquito and Beef, which is basically like XSS tunneling proxy, which I'm going to briefly cover at the end of the video. So Firefox is going to be used later to basically connect via the Chrome extension as a proxy. So this is the phishing email. When the victim clicks on the link, she's going to be redirected on the landing page in the web store with our extension. This is the kind of permission alert that the user gets, which is common in many extensions requires tabs permission, for example. So this is going to be pretty common. And as you can see on the terminal, as soon as the extension was installed, you can see a bunch of things going on, which is basically like the communication channel, which is using WebSockets. And as you can see here, these are all the open tabs, so Gmail, Web Store, example domain, and the InsomniHack website. And if you analyze what is going on behind the hood, you can see that the WebSocket connection is made. This is the Mosquito web interface, where you can see that we, as an attacker, we are able to see exactly what's going on in the victim browser in every different tab, and all you can basically have access to every raw HTTP request response. But not only this. So you can also use, if the victim is logged in Gmail, as you control the Gmail tab, because your JavaScript is running that origin via the Chrome extension, you can also like literally render that content that the user is seeing in his own logged in account. You can see it in your, in this case, Firefox, which is basically connected through a server socket in this Mosquito tool. And then when the requests are sent to the, when Firefox does a request to the server socket translates this raw HTTP request into JavaScript, which is injected then in the Chrome extension, and then is executed with the privileges of the user. So as you can see here, I'm browsing through the InsomniHack website, and that's on the left in the terminal, that's the whole traffic that is being generated and through the Chrome extension. So this is basically an example of how you can have complete control of what's going on in the browser. As you can see here, this is a Firefox again. I'm logged in as the user in his own Gmail account, just because in this tab he's logged in as well. So you can have like full control, and the user doesn't know exactly what's going on. So this is an example of how you can abuse Chrome extensions. Going further, as I said before, yeah, Firefox extension, they don't have any sandbox. You can read, write files, execute operating system commands. In Beef, I added a couple of modules, exploit modules, where you can basically create an extension and embed a dropper, so a vil encoded executable, for example, which is gonna bypass every antivirus in case the victim has antivirus installed in the machine. And in this way, as soon as the extension is installed, you get like your reverse meterpreter shell or whatever other payload you want to use. This is actually something that originally Michael Scheerl added to Metasploit, and then we ported it to Beef, adding a couple of actual use cases to trick the user into really installing the extension. So I will show you later. We created like a fake missing plugin yellow bar in the top of the browser. When the user clicks there, then he needs to click like install extension, stuff like that. Also, we are almost done on doing the same thing that we did on the Chrome extension for the Firefox extension in terms of controlling every tab via JavaScript. This is gonna be in Beef soon. So the example of the Chrome, of the Firefox extension is actually this one. I'm gonna skip all the like payload creation and basic like hooking via XSS. Oh, there you go. So now we have, this is the Beef admin interface. We have, we can control, as you can see here, Firefox. And we know that it's Firefox on Windows, so you even know that it's a VM. So in this case, we're gonna proceed with exploitation, but maybe you don't want to do that in a real case. When you execute the module, you just need to specify like which extension name you want to have, which one is the serving domain, because you can have like multiple Beef servers. The extension, as I said, is in this case an extension with an encoded executable. As soon as the extension is installed, the executable is run, and the reverse shell comes back to your Metasploit reverse handler in this case. So this is what's gonna happen. As you can see on the top, like we created dynamically with JavaScript and CSS, like a kind of fake missing plugin top bar. When the user clicks on install plugin, the not found is like a bug in the video. So this is what is gonna happen. And then once it's installed, you already have the session open. And you have like your reverse shell. And then, well, you can do whatever you want. So, other than this, there are another bunch of tricks that I want to show you. So, you remember HTML applications, also called HTA. If you search like HTA application virus, you find millions of results. So this is like definitely not a new thing, but it's actually pretty useful in my opinion. So this is like a simple and harmless HTML application that is served via a Ruby web application server. Like the interesting, like the HTA part is this one. So this is the code of the HTA, which is basically like creating a new ActiveX object and then running calc in this case, okay? This is actually the pop-up that the users see when you are serving the HTML application. So as you can see, name and publisher is something that you can't modify. It's something that is working like this by default. So it's actually pretty interesting for social engineering purposes. And publisher Microsoft Windows. Instead of running a calc, obviously you can do something more clever like running a PowerShell payload if the victim is on Windows Vista 7 or 8. In this case, the payload is basically like using PowerShell inline expressions to download the actual PowerShell payload from another server. The payload is executed and is always executed in memory. That's the best part. So I tried it like with Avast and Avira, free antiviruses. They obviously don't catch anything like this. The PowerShell payloads, you can find them in GitHub. There are a couple of guys that wrote them, like Manifestation and another guy. Probably the best payload is this one from Matthew Graber that deals with both x86 and x86-64 platforms. So you don't need to basically fingerprint in advance and then adjust your payload accordingly. And again, nothing touches the disk, so you don't even need to like obfuscate the payload most of the times. You can actually achieve the same thing, not only with an HTML application, but also with another legacy functionality that is present in Office, Microsoft Office, which are the macros. So macros by default are not disabled, but the default behavior in latest versions of Office, like 2010 or even later, it's like if the document contains a macro, the user see that kind of yellow bar, so he needs to click enable content. If the content is enabled, basically, again, your PowerShell payload triggers. I'm gonna show you a couple of videos as well. First of all, the HTA video. So this is like a social engineering email that I created saying, look, we are changing the website. You are gonna see these two pop-ups depending on your Internet Explorer settings. Please do open and then allow. And believe me that it works when I do my phishing engagement for work. So we're gonna start basically BEEF to serve the HTA payload and Metasploit with a bunch of like auto-run scripts like smart migrate to automatically migrate to another process. And so this is a victim hooked in BEEF in Internet Explorer 10 or 11. It works also in 11. So you just select the module. I've changed a little bit the UI for this module recently, so you don't have to configure all this stuff. You just need to like to specify one setting in case you are gonna try it after this talk. So in this case, we sent the module. This is the victim of Windows 7. Actually, no, we didn't send the module yet, sorry. Just moving Windows around, yeah, execute. So unfortunately, I couldn't find a way, even playing with content disposition in line, to basically prevent this pop-up to open. So there are two clicks involved, unfortunately. So when the user clicks open, oh yeah, in this case I already executed the HTA, so you don't see the other allow pop-up, but otherwise you would have seen the other allow pop-up. This is the HTA in the background. You can I modified this attack so you don't see anymore the pop-up, and then you get another shell again. Okay, the difference is the following. You didn't see the second pop-up simply because the website I was serving the HTA from, so let's say it's your compromised website or a site that you compromise and the user has in the trusted sites in Internet Explorer. In this case, I'm gonna remove it. From the trusted sites. Okay, remove the origin. And now you're gonna see the second pop-up. So let's say a completely remote scenario. Just to see the difference. It looks like another browser because I deleted also the cookies and everything, and BEEF keeps track of browsers based on a cookie that is set. So you execute again the module, and this time you get still, yeah, open save, and then you get this. As soon as the user click allow, you get, as you can see on the bottom left, you get a shell. And then the payload is migrated to another process. The nice thing about HTA is that the HTML application is not executed, is not parsed and run by the same Internet Explorer executable, but there is another executable involved, which is called mshta.exe. Now, it turns out that a friend of mine tried this module on Site Kiosk, latest version, and well, this is, I guess, is the only 0 day we have, because basically they couldn't reproduce, so they never fixed this. So basically, this is the example of how you can break out from Site Kiosk. So you use the very similar payload, still in HTA. Is doing this from, so imagine the use case. You are doing a pen test on a Site Kiosk, or you are at an airport, and you have beef running at your home, and then you want to basically compromise the Site Kiosk machine. So with this, basically, you can. You just need to use the HTA attack with the PowerShell payload. So this is like the virtual machine with the Site Kiosk. You're gonna see it as soon as you send the module. Basically, in this case, it's saving it because like you are acting like the victim and the attacker the same way, of course, because you are sitting in front of the Site Kiosk. So in this case, it's saving the HTA instead of just opening and executing it. And then, boom, you have the reverse shell on Metasploit listening to you, and then you compromise the Site Kiosk machine. So, I don't know if you are familiar with Phishing Frenzy, which is a tool written by Brendan McCann, a friend of mine that works for Acuvant. I'm helping him as well with like ideas and some phishing modules. We actually created a template for the HTA attack. So in case you use Phishing Frenzy, you can basically just use the HTA email template. And then as it is a template here, you are gonna have like your configurable link to your phishing domain. This is all public code. You can go here and like use it. This is actually the code that was used in the example before to break out from the Site Kiosk. So the HTA is actually doing three things. First of all, is killing watchdog, then it's killing sitekiosk.exe, and then it's finally executing our payload. And these strange JavaScript objects are Internet Explorer only. As you can see, MS Blob Builder, it works only on Internet Explorer. I'm sure that many people already tried to fuzz it. I'm not sure if they got bugs out of it, but yeah. Also, all the video that I showed, you can find them in my Vimeo Vimeo channel in case you want to watch them again. Few things that I want to speak about before the end of the talk is abusing UI expectation on Internet Explorer. This is something that most of this stuff is already like discussed in my book, of course. As I said before, this works in Internet Explorer 9 and 10. It's not patched. It's patched in Internet Explorer 11. So when you fingerprint the browser and you see that the version is 9 or 10, you can automatically trigger this module in beef. So what's the technicality behind it? So from Internet Explorer 8, modeless notification bars were introduced, okay? So no more pop-ups, looks like a bit better. And also, together with this modeless bar, Internet Explorer 8 introduced the smart screen filter, which is like a kind of bullshit reputational based, which really doesn't work. So every time, for example, you are on a website, the website is serving you an executable. That executable is actually run through the smart screen filter. And depending on the reputation that the executable has, so if Microsoft already scanned it, you can actually get like a yellow bar if it's like all right, or red, for example, if it's, you know, a virus, malicious code, whatever. The trick is that Rosario Valotta, my friend, found that the Symantec and Microsoft had an agreement, and if you use Symantec Enterprise Validation SSL certificate to sign your executable, then reputation doesn't matter. So you can have basically a virus, you sign it with the valid certificate, so you buy a company, you get a certificate, I don't remember, I guess it's less than $1,000, and then you can sign whatever you want until someone revokes it. And in this way, if you sign the executable with Symantec, like smart screen validation is completely bypassed, so you automatically get a yellow bar. Now, the second interesting thing is that these modeless dialogues can be controlled with keyboard shortcuts. And this specific thing is the thing that they disabled in Internet Explorer 11. So if you want to click run, you can also press the R key. Depending on the version of Internet Explorer, you need to press Tab, R, or just R. Obviously, this is like localization dependent. So for example, in Italian, is Esegui, so E. So it changes, but obviously when you can fingerprint the localization of the user very easily, as I do in BIF. So the trick is the following, that with the EVSSL from Symantec, you bypass the smart screen filter. Then you can control the smart screen filter via keyboard shortcuts, but it's not. There is a third trick, which is basically the following. If you spawn a popunder, if you dynamically create a popunder behind the main foreground window, and in the popunder you actually have an iframe that is pointing to the executable that you want the victim to run, what happens is that for some reason in Internet Explorer you can direct keyboard shortcuts that are arriving in the foreground window to the popunder. The popunder obviously can be spawned exactly behind the main window, so it's pretty much invisible to the user. And then the only thing that you need to do at the end is displaying a fake captcha in the main window. And for example, if the user is using an English browser, so R for run, you just display a fake captcha with the R, a couple of R keys as the first characters. The user click R, the R key press is directed to the popunder, which triggers the, you know, smart screen filter run action. And then, boom, you have another shell. So I'm gonna show you the like weaponized version. Where is it? So here we are starting BIF. This is the virtual machine with Windows 7 and Avastr saying that, of course, we are protected. And actually, Avastr, as you can see here, also runs some kind of internet plugin, Internet Explorer plugin that I guess is supposed to check for malicious stuff, but apparently doesn't do a great job. Yeah, we log in the BIF UI. We have our Internet Explorer 10 version browser hooked. And you just need to go, we also mount the executable that we want to run in BIF in a way that can be served from BIF. Once the user clicks the R key. So we just go to the module, we say this is the URL of the dropper that I want to execute on the victim machine. And as soon as this is configured, then you press execute. In this case, obviously I didn't bought the EVSSL certificate just for demo purposes, so this is like a malware that I found online that is already signed with that certificate. And is also like, you can see like the classic like install dialog just for demo purposes again. Otherwise it's completely silent. So you execute the module and also document body on click is overridden in a way that basically wherever the victim clicks, the fake CAPTCHA modeless dialogue is actually displayed. So in a way that you can have like a real legit site behind, and then through XSS you control that origin and then you do this module. So this is what happens when the module is executed. This is the pop-under, which you can see it just because the browser is not full screen, and also because I didn't position exactly behind, but you can do that. This is just for demo. This is the fake CAPTCHA. And as you can see, as soon as the victim press R for rotten, there you go. This is basically the executable that is triggering, and if you do it with like a normal dropper, you don't see anything. You just, again, for demo purposes. And then every time the victim clicks everywhere or press R, again, the same thing pops up. So unless she closed the browser, you win. Okay, last minute. So a few words about Java exploitation. We don't have time to see like Signed Java Applet in action, but again, it's not that useful anymore because from Java 1.7 update 51, you cannot run anymore self-signed applets. So you need to have a valid code signing certificate. Otherwise, the applet simply doesn't run. Obviously, if you have a signed applet, you can execute commands, you can read and write to the file system. You have like full machine compromise under the Java with the privileges of the Java process, so then you need to do a like privilege escalation in case. There are obviously modules in Biff for this. In case you want to buy a certificate, you can just like sign the applet and then deliver it through Biff. Also, another limitation is that Chrome and Firefox implemented click to play, and now basically you need to have a valid code signing certificate. You need to trick the user to bypass, to click, to allow the execution in the click to play in the browser. Then Java has its own click-to-play implementation. So there are, like, at the end, too many clicks involved. But in Internet Explorer, yet again, thanks Microsoft, because basically they didn't implement the click-to-play click-to-play feature yet. So even in Internet Explorer 11, if the victim has the Java plugin installed and running Internet Explorer, you can still use, eventually, the Java applet attacks. So I had some other stuff to show you, but 45 minutes or outro. Yeah, so with some degree of magic trickery and social engineering, you can still obtain good results without 0 days. Again, especially if you are not like targeting a specific company or, a specific person in a specific company. And still sometimes these, attacks still work. If you want to share 0 days with me later, I will be happy to listen to you. And that's it. If you have like maybe a couple of minutes for questions, and that's it. I'm done. Thank you.